Does that sound exciting, huh? Yeah. You know, we have a lot of days where our mouth is going down. But with this kind of information, it's going a little bit up, huh? Yeah, the hope they cannot take away from us. We are now so fortunate that we have a Danish journalist, which is actually very angry at his colleagues. Because he believes they are not doing what they are supposed to do. And they are not, they are biased, they are not critical enough. So Tommy Hansen have made a platform for information called free21.org, where politics, especially geopolitics, is described. You have a lot of connections also to writers for global research. How many of you know global research in here? Not too many. I can really, if you want something which is very, very, very detailed work with great evidence of the sayings and what they write and provement of the facts, then global research is very, very serious. I can only recommend for you to look into that and support it if you find it interesting. So please welcome our Danish journalist, Tommy Hansen.
Thank you very much. Oh yeah, right. Hello, everybody. No, I'm not angry. I'm not at all an angry person. But they don't do their job. He's totally right. I need something in my hand in order to get connected with this stuff. I'll just, we'll have to go one picture back, but that's another part. I'm very happy to be here. And I am, as I said, I'm a Danish journalist. I'm currently living in Portugal. I partly also live in France, and for a couple of years I've been living in Berlin, launching this free21.org concept, which is all about reintroducing real journalism in a sort of way that it's able to, it's available for the public. And I'll tell you very shortly about it. But otherwise, I'll also have to say the only reason that I'm here is because of 9/11. Because until then, I was totally biased myself. I was totally in. I'm sorry. I'll stay on this side. But I was used to being told where to stand also before 9/11. So. But I found out, so for a couple of years, I waited for my colleagues in the mainstream media to tell us about 9/11, which from the first day was obvious that something was wrong, which we now know, and I'm not going into details because I know a very heavy-duty researcher, Christopher Bullin, was here yesterday. And a lot of good researchers have been doing their job about 9/11. So today we know that, yes, it was an inside job. And the only reason that we don't see the consequences is because the media don't do their job. So I actually just got tired of trying to knock on doors, trying to persuade politicians. I published a book in 2008 in Denmark. Sent it to all the politicians in the Folketinget and the Danish Parliament, and I really, really thought on the next day my phone is going to ring. It would be the state's the Prime Minister telling me, "Mr. Hansen, you've done a great job. We'll take over from here." I really thought that, but this call never came. So I just got tired and I moved to Germany. And I, long story short, we are now more than 100 people running this free21.org. We are in 17 different countries, meaning we have people, researchers, layouters, people all over, and it is currently is running in, I think, 5 different languages, and we are coming. We are coming with a Russian version within the next 2 months. It's a special edition. It's the university in Donetsk who has asked us to publish a magazine in Ukraine on both sides of the border, telling them about the regime change in Ukraine. And why did they do that? They did that because we have already published a book about this subject. And this book is based on an interview that I did with Dr. Daniel Ganser, who's a historian and who doesn't go into conspiracies at all. So, facts, facts, facts. I heard there's a new magazine coming up in Denmark, and everything new is good. I needed to say this also because of my own website. Don't believe what I say. Don't believe it. You don't need to believe it. I really don't care. Go look for yourself. I'm a journalist, so what I do, I tell facts. I don't want to change society. You have to do that. So, I'm going to take you through a short journey in history, and I'll stay on the right side. It's not going to be a pleasant one, and you can always argue when, where to start. And instead of arguing, I'll just start. In 1945, as it was obvious for all parties that the Nazi Germany was going to collapse, the Allied forces decided to bomb 25 German cities, including Dresden. This is from February 45, where millions of Germans were killed. They were not Nazis, they were just Germans. 70% of the town was killed. You can see clearly in this picture, nothing is left. So we had basically a Europe which was totally on its knees. And we had no money. So, of course, it was needed that we sort of introduced some sort of tool to gain currency to be able to rebuild these countries. So, this Bretton Woods Agreement, the US dollar was made the second reserve currency in all the Western countries. That could make sense because, as Business Week writes here in 2011, for the first years it was all good because Europe was being rebuilt with the help of American money, American companies, American products, and all was good. So, problem is that the US was at war again, and they needed a lot of money. So, internationally, I'll just get back to understand this connection. You can look at the dollar bills from the United States. The upper one is the one where you can go into any Federal Reserve branch and get this transferred into gold, the value into gold. The second one is redeemable in lawful money, whatever that is. And in 1963, they just deleted this sentence. So, basically, since 1963, you may say it's just a piece of paper. It is just a piece of paper. So, in the 50s, rebuilding Europe resulted in the investors, the markets, wanting the local currencies. There were people wanted the D-mark again, they wanted the French currency again. They didn't want the US dollar, so the pressure on the US, or rather the decelerating demand for the US dollar was being a huge problem in the United States. So big that the German National Bank director in 67 had to write to the Federal Reserve and promise that we would never ever want to change our dollars into gold. We will never ever come with that claim. And he even assured that it will never ever happen in all future. And you can find it on the website. I also say, I'll have to say technically, almost everything is with sources, and the idea is afterwards you can find this on YouTube, you can pause it and look at the quotes and everything and go look at the sources for yourself. So I won't get into a lot of details with what's on the screen. But it is obvious there was a very large pressure because the US, no one actually wanted the US dollar anymore. We didn't need it. Europe was running alone. So in 71, Nixon called this process speculating against the dollar, and with a good American sense of logic, he said, we will do anything to defend the dollar. And of course, the people were saying, yeah, we will defend the dollar. Of course, we will. And 2 years later, all we civilized people were into this deal, actually meaning from now on, we have no guarantee whatsoever that this piece of paper is worth anything more than a piece of paper. And this system allows what a good researcher as well, David Icke, calls corrupt governments to rule the masses, because they have free access to huge amounts of monies always available for big World Bank projects or for war investments at any given time, and that's what was created on that day. If, as if that was not enough, in 74 they introduced this petrodollar system, which means that the Saudis were told, from now on you may only accept United States dollar as currency in order to sell your oil. And in exchange, the US promised the Saudis, we will build up military bases all over your country to defend you from your enemies, and we will build up your secret services as part of the deal. So, who was in 76, 77 director of the CIA? It was the older George Bush, George Bush Senior. And again, I don't even need to go into details because this is almost a matter of public record. As Russ Baker says, what Puppy did, that's his nickname, he used it himself, what President Bush did, he actually made a private copy of the CIA and ran it in Saudi Arabia. And that way, all the secret dark operations that he couldn't present to Congress, or wouldn't present to Congress, he could freely operate them in Saudi Arabia. And ladies and gentlemen, it's been like that ever since. That's my analysis. The Saudis are ruled by a royal family. They are known for severe violations against human rights. They are stand against anything that we as Christians, as human beings, as normal thinking people could ever, ever accept. But they have the largest oil company in the world. And Alex Deval has says the Saudi ruling elite is operating something like a sophisticated criminal enterprise. That's called a mafia. And still we are good friends with them. Obviously, we are all good friends with the Saudis. I really can't see any reason why. I don't know if this sword has been used for anything, but the symbolic is quite astonishing, I find. And now they're even head of the United States or the United Nations Human Rights. Noam Chomsky says, and he explains it very well, that not only is Saudi Arabia directed by an extremist version of Islam, but this extremist version is transferred into a totally perverted version of thinking, and that's the ticking of the ISIS. And that is why the Saudis support the ISIS, because they basically want the same sort of rule, the same sort of society, where heads are chopped off if you don't do the right things, if you don't stand in the right place. So our cartoonist in Free 21 has allowed himself to express it that way. And just as a quick instruction, the upper flag is the United Nations and the lower flag is the Saudi Arabia. So, or the ISIS, sorry. But what's the point of arguing? These people getting together in the 80s, 70s, 80s, needed instruments to traffic the money. And the first one, which we know of, was the BCCI. How many people here know the BCCI? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all right. That's almost something, but you should all know it. And moreover, people out there should know about it. You can Google it. The BCCI was a construction of top criminal crooks doing top level criminal businesses. Everything was there. Money laundering, bribery, support of terrorism, arms trafficking, kidnapping, murder, everything was there, and it was on record in this bank. It had 1,500 employees, was founded by a couple of rich Saudi Arabians, and was by the time called the world's sleaziest bank. It was foreclosed in 1991, and you know what? Nothing happened. Just went away. I never heard of anyone being actually prosecuted or anything, and Jimmy Carter was involved. They had made businesses with Manuel Noriega, with Saddam Hussein, with the Medellin cartel, doing drug businesses. It was all there, on record. And there was a huge uproar in the American Senate, or in the Congress, and then it went away again, because then we had something else to talk about. I also must say, what they did there, 72 to 71, 91, is 100% exactly the same as they have been doing with these so-called Panama Papers, which we also don't talk about anymore, strangely enough. But there we have exactly the same people, and you have to look in the small independent papers where they are. The Irish Times is one of them. There I found this article that the Panama Papers are already now being connected to the Iran-Contra affair and to the CIA gun trafficking. So, again, ladies and gentlemen, we don't talk about it because we know, we all know, the Panama Papers, that was something about Putin, wasn't it? Yeah, it was, I know. Another instrument which they used was the Carlyle Group. They still use it. And how many in here know the Carlyle? Now that's comforting. So I really don't have to say a lot about it. It's a bunch of former presidents and top politicians being paid for their deeds during their political careers. And that's what it's all about. And they're being paid very, very well. And it is the 11th, or was in 2003, according to The Observer, the 11th biggest arms contractor to Pentagon. So we have this company making former presidents billionaires because of their war decisions. And this company is a contractor, is delivering, is making money on the wars that Pentagon wage. What a genius system. These guys have been operating in the Western world for the last 30, 40 years, 50 years maybe, probably since World War II. In the 60s, 70s, the Cold War was making these guys and their families, their fathers, rich as you wouldn't believe it, because there was no limit for investments as long as it was all about war, as it as nowadays. But in 1992, I still remember, the wall in Berlin came down, the world was ready for peace, we were all going to hold hands and just love being alive, because we were out of enemies. And that was the problem. I thought that was a good thing, but no, that was the problem. And you can see that in the report, Rebuilding America's Defenses from 1997. You can read it for yourself, that it was a problem, because no one wanted to invest in American war industry anymore. Stocks were going down, orders were not there, no one wanted war. So why produce cannons when you have no war? Fact is, they kept on producing cannons, and they just make wars to get rid of the cannons. They were desperate in 1997, and they needed a new war. You can read that as well in this report. It's describing how the American war industry is going to reintroduce itself as the world's leading force, and how America could regain political force to this global policemanship that they've turned into. And that's what the report is all about. And it describes in details the new weapon systems we are seeing now, the drone systems we are seeing, in details, all these killing machines. You find them there with beautiful graphic images and descriptions. That is what we need. That's what they say, these people. And then they say, this process where we are going, it's going to take a long time if we don't have a new Pearl Harbor. It was published in September 2000, and I don't need to say anything more about that, actually. Again, the report was uncovered by the Sunday Herald in 2002, and there it was called the blueprint for the creation of a global Pax Americana. Well, that was the Sunday Herald, and since then we haven't thought about that, but that's the fact. That's what they wanted, these neo-con, conservative, rich Americans. Another astonishing fact from the recent history is that in October 2001, the Pentagon had detailed plans of how to take out 7 countries in the next 5 years. And take out, that means take out. It doesn't mean go to war with, it means take them out. Make sure that they have no influence anymore. And we know that from General Wesley Clark, who was interviewed by Democracy Today, and where he said, he even named them, it was Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. It's on record, you probably know it, all of you, but then why didn't we see this interview in the mainstream media? He's not a Johnny something, he's a four-star general, he's the former head of the NATO force in the Yugoslavia, so he should know what he's talking about, and still not a word about it. But it's quite astonishing that when you look at the countries now producing refugees for the Western world, you can just say, check, 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 check. Okay, Sudan, we're still working on that. Iran may be coming, but then we took Afghanistan as well. You have to understand how America, how it functions financially. The household, the American household, is divided in two parts. One part is ruled by law, what to spend money on. The other part, the politicians are free to go, so to speak. And in this free part, 57% of the investments go to war. 57% of the money that the politicians can choose to use, they use on war. We also have to know that who pays the party rules the party, and the US is financing NATO. So please forget any talk about any sort of democracy or anything at all. It's a war machine. And you should look at the arms exports from the US to these regions where now millions of refugees are knocking on our door. And that should be a job for the mainstream media, but they don't. And I'll show you why in just a second. The Swiss Peace Research Institute, a very good friend of mine, Dr. Daniel Ganser, has made this graph about the war exports, and you see clearly where the United States, there's no country coming even close to that. That means that the whole society is dependent on war. A little good man having a factory producing underwear, whatever, he may be good at producing underwear, and he has a couple of hundred employees, they're all doing underwear, and someday they get a contract with Pentagon because the soldiers need underwear as well. He's not a war maker, he's not a bad guy at all, but he's living off this war machine. And that's where we're at now. Dr. Daniel Ganser also told me how historians detect an empire, because I was told in the school, I was taught about empires, but I have never heard the word the American Empire till recently. It wasn't in my school book, not at all. Empires were past. Now we have democracy and freedom. They count, the historians count, and they say, who has the largest amount of aircraft carriers? That's one criterium. And you can say clearly, America has 10, United Kingdom has 2, China 1, and Russia 1. Okay, okay. The English also say, but we don't have people for them anymore, but that's another part, yeah. But the fact is, there's only one reason for an aircraft carrier. Just consider it. Why do we need it? We need it in order to be able to carry out war a long, long way from home. That's why. There's no other reason. No. It's not a defense weapon. It's an attack weapon. It's a weapon of an empire. They also say who have the most military bases throughout the world. And I mean, with far more than 800, America is by all means number one in the world. What are they doing out there? I don't know. Here you see this misconnection between the costs in the United States, war costs, running the whole society. So we have a nation addicted to war now telling us where to go and fight for freedom and democracy. I really don't understand how the politicians can allow this to be continued, and they won't. Not for it won't be because the people won't have it. You won't let it. But how can they do that? They can do that because they think of themselves as an empire. They have a lot of think tanks. These Project on a New American Century is one of them, and they have the Stratfor, which is one of the most important and influence think tanks in the United States. And the founder recently said that the priority of the USA is to prevent the German capital and technology to be united with Russian natural resources and labor to form an invincible combination. That was where we were at in 1992. We could have had a lot of friendly relations with the Russians, a lot of cooperation, a lot of cultural, it would have been a beautiful world. But not according to these neocon, because then they would lose their power as empire. America would be broke within a year if we could use Russian minerals and resources combined with Western technology and labor. You would never dream of the wealth that we as a continent would have had. And as he said, creating a cordon sanitaire around Russia will eventually allow the US to hold on a leash Germany and all the European Union. Wrap your mind around that sentence. It's absolutely, think about a Danish prime or Danish top politician saying things like that. We would laugh him out, wouldn't we? No one should be allowed to have this sort of worldwide Big Brother role, but they have given themselves this role. Obama, the nice guy, well, he is had a Peace Prize recently, didn't he? So he must be some sort of good. He said in 2015 in an interview with Vox that we occasionally have to twist the arms of countries that wouldn't do what we need them to do. I remember from the school, I was told, don't twist the arms of people. No, I wasn't, but when people twisted my arms, they were being told, don't do that. And it's against our way of thinking. We shouldn't teach our children to solve problems by twisting the arms of someone, shouldn't we? So how can we have a president of the world's greatest nation thinking like that? We have. How can we have a nation who has made a law allowing them to military intervention in the International Court, Criminal Court of Justice in Hague in case that a US citizen would be held for trial there? What could possibly make President Bush in 2002 think we need a law in order so we can deliberate any American that might be put before this court in Hague? What sort of event could that have been that he wanted to protect Americans against? I have a guess, but I'll just rest my case. But how many here knows about this Hague Invasion Act? Have you heard about it? No? Okay. The world's mightiest power has a law saying that when a US citizen is being put for trial, we can intervene military and take him back. And this law, this the whole court, was by Senator Jesse Helms in the preparations, called the International Kangaroo Court. It's sort of an unpleasant way of talking about an institution which we in the Western world use to handle very, very high scale worldwide crimes, to think of it as a kangaroo court. But they do. And when they twist the arms, it looks like that. It always looks like that. I can recommend John Perkins' Confessions of an Economic Hitman, which shows clearly that the United States foreign policy has three steps. Step one, we offer a lot of money to a corrupt government, and normally they say yes. Step two, if they say no, we send in the jackals, and then normally they say yes. Step three, if they say no, we send in the military. So you can just pick your choice. That's American diplomacy, according not only to him, but to a lot of observers. A lot of observers know that that's how things are run nowadays. So they twist the arms in Syria, they twist the arms in Afghanistan, they twist the arms in Somalia, they twist the arms in Iraq in 1990. The old Bush made the sanctions, where after 5 years, 500,000 Iraqi kids were dead. That's a fact, historical fact. And this bloody woman was asked, was it worth it? And after considering, she very bravely said, yes, it's a hard choice, but the price, we think the price is worth it. It wasn't her children. And dying after sanctions means normal starving to death. It's a very slow sort of, a slow way of dying, which was worth it, according to her standards. Fact is, if you look at the American history, the nation has a new war every 4 years. 93% of the time, the nation has lived for 239 years, and in 222 of these years, there has been a war. So not only economically, but you may say cultural, America is dependent on war. America is used to having the right to intervene in any country they can reach in order to twist their arms. And they say so themselves. And still, we pretend that we're part of a democratic circus, which is an insult to any normal thinking human being. And then, of course, we had this 9/11 and the never-ending global war on terror. It's a big, big moneymaker. It will never go away because we don't need any evidence anymore. We just go for the bad guys. Either you're with us or you're with the terrorists. So it's a black-white world now. And the winners, obviously, the winners we can say right now for the world, for the war on terror, it's the international arms industry. It's all the surveillance, all this security. It's international transports, as we all know, as Danes, Maersk is one of the heavy contractors of Pentagon as well. It's the Carlyle Group, and it's all going upwards. Everything is going as planned. Also, the winners are these bunch of low-life, corrupt politicians pretending to take care of the people. Sorry to say. And they can't even say, they have, for some years they have been able to say, well, we didn't know about it. But they can't. They can't anymore. It's deadline, and they know it. And I can tell you that all over in Germany, all over in France, all over in Portugal, people have had it. In all parts of society, we have subscribers to our magazine in the German military. I have very good contacts, high-ranked officers, telling me what we are doing and what I'm saying is facts, facts, facts. And they don't want this escalation of war They don't want to go to war against the Russians, but they have nowhere to go, he says. We have nowhere to go. We can't go upstairs. Then our careers are ended. We can't go to the media. They won't write about it. So they have nowhere to go. But they have had it. And this change, this revolution, you may call it, is just around the corner. We just don't know about it because it's not being blown out in the mainstream media. But I can really assure you, things are going to get very well and very soon. So we'll get rid of those. We have to understand that there is a deep state in the US. This question mark, you can delete. There is a deep state in the US, and there is a deep state in every country in the world who has a war industry. It's that simple. Every country producing arms and war machines, they have a secret service. This secret service is instrument for this war machine, and they influence politicians and media in every country in the West. The reason why I talk a lot about the CIA is because right now, our empire is called America, and our empire is about to win, as we clearly can see with the 800 military bases and all these aircraft carriers. They are about to win and take over all this control, which you can look at the Stratfor website. I would like you to look at it because it's all laid out there what they want, the strategy. Russia shall be divided into three regions and never ever rise again. There's a lot of interesting reading on their website. So a lot of authors throughout the time have been writing books about these secret state in the United States. And these are just a very few examples. You can find them afterwards on the web. We need to remember what Eisenhower said in 1961 as he was saying goodbye to the American people. He warned them, as he said, I quote, "In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist." Those were the words from the outgoing president to the American people. And he said, only an alert and knowledgeable citizenry can do anything against it. And that's you, ladies and gentlemen. That's you. Because the problem hasn't gone away. It persists. Kennedy said exactly the same in his speech in April 27, 3 months later, 12 days after the Bay of Pigs. He said, there is no escaping either the gravity or the totality of this threat of its challenge to our survival and to our security. He said, we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy. The official version is he was talking about the communists, but he would say so. There was no problem at all at that time pointing to the communists. They did that at every time they could. So would he. He talked about the secret societies. He talked about the military-industrial complex that Eisenhower warned about. And he said this system, which can be the Russians, the communists, it can be them, possible but not likely, this system has a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. But my God, that is a secret service operation he's talking about. That's the CIA. He is talking about the CIA. He's warning against the CIA. And he even said, this system conducts the Cold War. No one has ever, ever accused the Russians for conducting the Cold War. It has always been a two-part thing that both parties knew. We have this Cold War, so we need investment in this and that, and the war industries in both countries did very well as a result of that. But who was behind this Cold War? That was the system that Kennedy warned about. So, let's face the beast. The name is CIA, and every time you find something about illegal operations, covert wars, drug smuggling, terror support, regime changes, the CIA footprints are all over. I remember before 9/11, when I thought CIA is a very good thing. They have beautiful structures and doing good deeds and running around with guns and just doing their job. But man, what a job! They were founded in 1947, same year as the Bretton Woods agreement, or in this period. And what they do, you can see in their own report from 2004, they run prisons all over the world where they torture people. They write it themselves. That's what they do. This is from the salt pit in Afghanistan, one of the most famous ones. The box below is written by one of the inmates. That's a box for holding prisoners during the daytime when they're not interrogated. And of course they have put nice little holes in the box so they can breathe. And if they're not in the box, they're put on this piece of wood, and they're being waterboarded. You can read that, all that, in the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence report from 2012, 6,000 pages about this procedure. And you can find all this information, how they run secret prisons in Poland, in Hungary, in Bulgaria, you name it. Everywhere where a corrupt government allows the CIA to put in a prison, they are. They have been flying, they've been kidnapping and flying people all over Europe for years and years. Now they've told us they don't do it anymore, so I don't believe shit what they say, not a word. But they had 1,245 flights, we know that, in 2007, and as Senator Dick Marty said, at least 100 people have been kidnapped by the CIA in Europe. And then they're just being taken off the street, put into an aircraft carrier and flown somewhere remote to Guantanamo or whatever. Or in, as we know since 2003, in Iraq, this Abu Ghraib prison, just to instruct you, this poor guy there, he has wires taped to his fingertips and his testicles, and he's told if he falls down, he's going to die a very unfortunate death. So he tries to keep standing. And that's standard procedure. Even this very famous Lindy England, who has been teaching American military academies about interrogation methods after her punishment, she even says today she would do the same. What the heck? They were enemies. That's what she said. And that's our partners treating people like that. Guantanamo, we all know, God, thank God Obama came and he was going to close it down. I even believe that too. But it's still there, isn't it? And the preferred interrogation technique at Guantanamo is this waterboarding. The only confessions that we have about 9/11 are based on torture. That's a fact. The 9/11 Commission has intensively written about three people being tortured and their statements after torture, and that's the whole foundation that they can say, yes, we were behind. I mean, he was waterboarded 183 times, Sheikh Mohammed, before he said, yes, I was behind 9/11. And he confessed to a couple of other things I don't remember right now. I would do so too. They should even just have to threaten me with being waterboarded. I don't like to drown. So when something like that happens, they make a very big report, as they did in 2014. 6.3 million documents have they been through. And it made it was a scandal in the press, and everyone all over the world said, now, finally, the CIA should be made responsible for its acts. But the problem is, the acts of the CIA goes all the way up to the presidency of the United States, and no one wants to question that institution. That's the problem. So we find something else to talk about. I'll just give you a few examples of the deeds of the CIA that we know of. In 1951, around 500 people were given LSD. We don't know if it was through the bread in the village or it was from the air distributed, but 500 people in this French village was given LSD. They sprang out of windows, they ran around in the village screaming and were having demons in their stomach and all the classic symptoms. And no one knew what was happening, so they sent a delegation to find out from a nearby chemical factory in Switzerland, Sandoz, and they concluded it was there was something wrong with the bread. It was molded bread. But this group of scientists were led by Albert Hofmann, who was the first person in the world to synthesize LSD. He did that in 1938. And Santos was delivering LSD to the CIA, to the experiments that we also know in a moment that they already did in the 50s in the United States. So what they wanted was to see what happens if we distribute LSD. We just want to know what happens. They were looking for the final weapon against the communists, you must remember, and then everything is allowed. As I said, in 1975, this report to the president on the CIA activities within the United States should have ended the CIA once and for all. It contains so many disastrous, you wouldn't dream of what they have been doing. To people not knowing it, in hospitals they have spread in uranium in the veins just to see what happens. They have used heroin, morphine, mescaline, everything they had just to see what happens. We are looking for a weapon against the communists, remember? And they used inmates, they used hospital patients, used all sorts of people not knowing what was going on. And it was written by in the press, and that's why this whole thing came out. And the program MK Ultra was for the first time recognized as being official in this report to the president from 1975. It was a program of research in memorial behavioral modification, meaning brainwash, in all sorts of ways, with chemicals, with electronic stimulations, with subliminals, with everything you can imagine. So, if you look in the press, it is all over, and again, and again, and again, and again, the CIA is mixed up with covert operations, immoral things, drug dealing, gun running, and all this stuff. In 2007, an airplane belonging to the It's belonging to the American Drug Administration. The airplane was at that time registered to this institution, contained 4 tons of cocaine, was headed for Colombia, or the other way around, don't remember, and nothing happened. The same plane with the same tail number has already been registered on the record as one of the planes used for these illegal CIA prisoners flights all over Europe. So it is a CIA plane containing 4 tons of cocaine. That was in 2007. 2014, in Australia, a local airport has now been connected with guns and drugs through the airline company Air America, which is a front for the CIA. The CIA has tens of thousands of companies, tens of thousands, and Air America is one of the most famous ones. Just some of the secret operations that there are, that we know the CIA were behind, some of the bigger ones. The Iranian coup, we know they overthrew a democratic selected president and put in a dictator. The Bay of Pigs tried to actually do the same thing. In Brazil, 64, they did it. In Bologna, 1980, they tried to create terror, system change maybe, terror, definitely, with the Operation Gladio, which the Italian president Andreotti in 1992 blew wide open, saying that people with connections to a Western intelligence were behind the Bologna bombings in 1980. And he didn't say which Secret Service, and he didn't have to. Everybody knows. The European Parliament, they made a resolution on this Operation Gladio thing, which for the ones that don't know, it was secret groups in the NATO stay behind forces that were established in every country in Western after World War II. Secret groups were put in to these structures, and they were right-wing extremists, they were anti-communists, they wanted to do anything violent in order to... I really don't understand how they're ticking, but that's a fact. And they did so. And these people were behind a lot of terror events in the 80s, and the... I don't know when it stopped, but it was exposed in 1992. And as always, we were told, all right, there were some crooks, some bad guys among us, but we'll never ever do it again. So the European Parliament said in 1990 about all this whole affair, we urge that every country make an investigation as to how deep does this go. And no country made this investigation. In Denmark, it was called Operation Absalon. This Operation Gladio thing, so you can go Google it for yourself. And just to show I'm not anti-American, I'm not anti-anything, I'm just a journalist, the KGB is doing exactly the same thing as I've been talking about, because that's what secret services do for empires. That's what they do. So the KGB also support terror groups that could result in a regime change with a more Soviet-friendly government. That's exactly what they tried to do all over the planet. And they did so in all these mentioned examples. We know from the New York Times, 2014, that the secret services in the US have recruited Nazis during the Cold War, during the 50s and the 70s, 60s. Lots and lots and lots of top Nazis were recruited, and the blind eye was put to their deeds in the past because of their value in order to fight the communists. You could write a book about it. You could fill a whole library with books about the deeds of the CIA, because the books have already been written. Somehow the journalists don't read books anymore. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe that's what made Truman say the CIA was a mistake, and if I'd known what was going on, I would never have allowed it. He also said we should limit their role to pure intelligence. The problem is that we don't know about the CIA and their deeds, because the CIA controls the media as well. And if I had heard myself say that 15 years ago, I would say, go fuck yourself, I'm sorry. But they do. They do. And I know. In 77, Carl Bernstein wrote that more than 400 American journalists were on the payroll of the CIA. Last year, the German Minister of Finance, Oskar Lafontaine, says this year that some German journalists are told to write what to write by the CIA should be a well-known fact by now. He knows what he's talking about. So let it be a well-known fact. The CIA is providing articles for journalists in the Western media. Let it be a well-known fact. And as my colleague, Udo Ulfkotte, he wrote a book 2 years ago, he says that the corruption of journalists and major news outlets by the CIA is routine, it's accepted, and it's widespread. And how they do is, they have a club, like a Bilderberg model, a club with the name Atlantic Brücke. There, all the senior editors of all the big medias in Germany meet with top politicians, top investors, top banksters, top everything, and that's how they agree what to tell. The other organizations, just to show the system, they have clubs in every major part of society. So, meaning they have a club for journalists specializing in medicine and healthcare, which could be the explanation that we very rarely hear about well-working alternative medicine and methods of healing, including how to get rid of cancer and other very well-known facts. Why don't we hear about it in the mainstream media? Maybe because they sit with the journalists and sort of make a plan of what to tell about. So, just very briefly, this Atlantic Brücke, like most of the other constructions for journalists, like Bilderberg's, this model, was founded in 52 by a very, very rich German banker, Warburg. He is, through his family and lifelong friends, heavily connected to the American money-making system, just to make it short. And who wants to read more about that should read the book The Creature from Jekyll Island, which shows how the American Federal Reserve System was created in order as a foundation for this whole situation we have today, where dollar is being distributed and with no control at all, and just making the banksters richer and richer. If this is true, you could expect a sort of unity, couldn't you? Yes. And there is. We all talk about the same. I'll give you one example. On the 8th of June 2015, we had this G7 summit, and all the German newspapers had this picture of Angela Merkel and Obama on top of the front page on the same day. You could say, well, yeah, oh, it was a German, it was in a German castle, wasn't it? So, yeah, it was, yes. So here are more German newspapers with the same story at the same place at the same time. But it was not only German newspapers. Now we go out in the world. It was, I can't even pronounce these. I don't even know the countries where they come from, but they find this story so interesting. All these editors around the world have found this story so interesting, it's going to be on top of the front page. And it's getting worse. It's still the same day. Now we're talking about the Wall Street Journal, the Guardian, Le Figaro, the Times. They all put this picture of Angela Merkel and Obama on top of the front page. How come? You should know that when you make a print medium, the top of the front page is the very, very last thing you do. You sit in the room, you have two or three options ready to go. You sit there, you look at the world, you look at the telegrams coming in, what's happening, and we always reserve the top of the first page, and you know for what? That's what we say in the business. In case Jesus really comes. So, it's not a coincidence what's being put there. And still, well, it's a nice picture, it is, really. But we have to think that newspaper editors all over the world have been sitting there on that day, waiting for the deadline and the final decision. And all of a sudden, this picture ticks in, and they all shout out, clear the front page, I've got it now. Or they had talked about it before. I choose the latter. Because if you analyze the media, we all talk about the same thing at the same time. In every bloody country in the West. And that's been puzzling me for years. How can that be? But that can only be because it's got nothing to do with journalism. A very good friend of mine, journalist Paul Taylor, who's with us at Free 21, said journalism died on 9/11, and I tend to give him to say he's right. At least it did. Maybe it died even before, but then it went away on that day. Since then, it's all been propaganda. Now we talk about sex scandals, it's always good, comes up every two or three months, something like that. Here we talk about Ebola, one man being tested for maybe positive in one airport in America, and here we go. Man tested in Ebola for Ebola in New York City. Here we talk about Putin, the bad guy, and I mean you can just see how bad he is. You don't even need any arguments. The same goes with the ISIS. We all talk about the same things at the same time. And if you notice, strangely enough, normally when big sports events are running or something like that, the world is at peace. Somehow, then they all talk about sports on that day, and well. Good thing that the terrorists at least expect some of our values. Here we talk about drone killings, which is an absurd term. You can see how this bad guy is being targeted by this drone, so now we got rid of just another terrorist. Right. Could have looked like that, because when a drone hits, it doesn't just target this one person who hasn't been tried for anything, he's just accused, it just blows off. So at this point, it was a US attack in Somalia, 150 dead, because they were looking for a terrorist. So I went to the Council on Foreign Relations website because I wanted to understand how can we now at once can we accept murder as a part of a war? Because when you send out a drone and you drop bombs, you murder people. It is not regulated in international warfare laws because it's murder. So I wondered how can we do it now? The explanation, you can find it on the Council on Foreign Relations website, is that this targeted killing, as it's called, it's not a term distinctly defined under the international law, but it gained currency in 2000 after Israel started doing so. That means, okay, killing is all right because Israel already started. That's the argument that we, the West, now use, that we kill people randomly all over the globe every week with weapon systems delivered by all us good people in the West. And we know 90% of the people killed were not even the targets. This drone trafficking is run from a German military base, Ramstein. And again, I can tell you, there's a huge resistance, demonstrations against the American presence in Germany, people saying, what are they actually doing here? How can they commit murder from our military bases on German soil? There's been said for years and years, never ever again shall a war go out from Germany. And we have a persistent war going out from Germany now, run by America. This war, which has been destabilizing the region for 10 years, 15 years, have resulted in a lot of refugees. And we know that in 2015, around 4 million were gathered in the area in Syria, around Syria. You can see clearly no one going to Saudi Arabia. It's only 60 kilometers, but they don't want to go there. So they take the route north and come to Europe. This wave of refugees started in August, September 2015. And it was initiated by a Twitter campaign. Tweets all over the world were saying, refugees are welcome, and then a country name was mentioned. So it was sort of, and it was political correct, and a lot of mainstream politicians made along, also tweeted and retweeted all these good messages. Look at examples here, refugees welcome, a picture from Germany, a German football stadium, and it was tweeted all over the world. So a huge amount of refugees came to Germany, first of all to Germany. The Russian Academy of Science has analyzed these tweets, and it was not Germans making these tweets. Actually, it was only, if you see, Germany was mentioned in 76% of the tweets saying refugees are welcome, and then a country name. So Germany was the country with welcoming the refugees with their open arms. But if you analyze it, you could see that these tweets saying go to Germany, they came from England, from the United States, and from Australia. So it was not the German people rising, saying, come, we'll love you, we'll help you. No, it wasn't. It was a series of netbots, botnets, or whatever you want to call them. Those are digitally generated computer armies, it's the same method you use to lay down a website, and they can carry out orders. And what they did, they made a lot of these automated netbots, they made these issues a new welcome. Activists launched home placement service for refugees in Germany and Austria, and then a lot of hashtags. It came out not from one computer, but from 40 bots of computers, generating tens of thousands of tweets that was then picked up by all the good people all over the world saying, wow, Germany wants to help the refugees, so I retweet. So all of once, these people standing out there only had one thing in their head, let's go to Germany. And so they did. If you think migration is not part of war strategy, you have to think again. And it's not a new thing at all. You can read historical books about it, you can read new books about it, and I would recommend the Pentagon's new map, which is quite astonishing. But if you read it, you see the total logic. You know that war and crisis make refugees destabilize, if there are enough of them, the countries that they come to. And that's the whole name of the game, to keep power balance. So make sure people are kept where you can control them. Countries are kept where you can control them, even if you have to twist their arms. And that's how we have this new term, terror. I'll just stick to the facts. Brzezinski made an interview in 1998 with the Nouvel Observateur. It's on the website of the University of Arizona, so I tend to believe it. He says, according to the official version of history, CIA aid to the Mujahideen began during the 1980s, but the reality, secretly guarded until now, is it was July 3rd, 1979, that President Carter signed the first directive for the secret aid to the opponents of the pro-Soviet regime in Kabul. So he is he's so proud of what they did that he won't let us live with the illusion that the CIA went in after the Soviets invaded Afghanistan. No, he wants us to know we were the cause of it. We were the cause that the Soviets invaded Afghanistan. We did it. And he had explained that to the president on the same day. You can also look at this astonishing interview in 2009 that Hillary gave gave to CBS, 60 Minutes, where she says it seemed like a great idea back then to embolden and train and equip Taliban, Mujahideen jihadists against the Soviet Union. And with our help, including at that time, Bin Laden, with the Pakistani support and support from Bin Laden, we actually did it. And she means Osama Bin Laden. Yes, she means Osama Bin Laden, because he was helping them at that time. But then she says, we left the problems of a well-equipped, fundamentalist, ideological, and religious group to the people. And that is exactly what has been going on now in Syria. And you can look at the Pentagon strategy papers written in 2012. It's a secret Pentagon report, but published yet by Judicial Watch in 2015. There you see, black on white, that the US is arming and supporting Al-Qaeda, the Muslim Brotherhood, and another terrorist organization right now in the northern Iraq and in Syria. And why are we doing that? Because they are fighting against Assad. They want to get rid of Assad. It is all in the Pentagon strategy papers. So they're trying to make a regime change in Syria, and they are arming and training the crazy terrorists in order to make them do the job. It's a proxy war. And as you see, these moderate rebels can now have now a training camp in Saudi Arabia, it's a good thing. So they can get the job done. This brave NATO general also explains ISIS as being, it's like a Frankenstein. And who knows the story of Frankenstein knows what he means. How do they get their money? Well, they get it from the United States. It's a matter of fact, public record. Even The Guardian wrote about it. How the US sent $12 billion into Iraq and just watched the money go away. A little bit of it has been found in a bunker in Libya, but it's all gone. This guy just wrote a book about it, James Risen, and he says how he describes how this money came in every month on military planes, tons and tons and tons of US dollar notes, and it was meant to go to the new creators, Iraqi National Bank, but never made it. So maybe that's how the ISIS got a little bit of their money. You can read about it in some of these brave books. It's gone to a point now where they don't even know who they're fighting. Recently, groups that were armed and trained by the Pentagon has been fighting groups that had been armed and trained by the CIA in Syria. And they don't give a shit. The United States don't give a shit because it's good for business. As long as someone's killing someone, we tend to survive. There again, you see this picture. We should be ashamed to be part of a circus with a nation that's dependent on war. We should stop it immediately, and we will. This is gone absurd to an extension that it's hard to believe anymore. Right now, South Africa is making a bomb factory in Saudi Arabia, so they don't have to transport all the bombs that they need over these long distances. It's much, much cheaper to make them on location because they need a lot of bombs in Saudi Arabia. For 1.5 years, they have been bombing in Yemen every week, and again, and again, and again. And they do that because we are bombing Shiite extremists. That's what we're told. Yemen, that's a Shiite extremist, and that's what's left of his home, I think. That was a wedding party. Shiite extremists, Shiite rebels. That was a hospital, Doctors Without Borders. That's why Saudi Arabia now needs a bomb factory in the country, because they need more and more bombs. And here we have, March this year, not a word in the mainstream media, demonstration in Yemen, where the people say, stop this United States Saudi Arabia aggression against us. Please, stop it. What should they do other than gather on the market? What you see every time, it's a war on infrastructure. Every bloody time, people are, this is Israel bombing Gaza's only power plant. What's the point of bombing a power plant in a country where you're not at war with them, but still. That was Iraq, that was Syria, always infrastructure. In Kobane, we were told it was occupied by Islamic State, and here we stand celebrating as the bombs go down. That's Kobane after the bombing. I don't know, maybe a city size of Skive or something like that. But definitely, for years and years and years, it's not going to function as a city. It's going to take years for them just to reach a normal level again. That was the Islamic State headquarters, we were told, in Mosul, Iraq. 55 people were killed, and the whole university was destroyed. Knowledge from years and years and years is now gone, and we were told terrorists were there. Doctors Without Borders, hospital in Afghanistan, US airstrikes, they say Taliban were firing from this building. Doctors Without Borders say it's bullshit. It never happened. So you can choose to believe who you want. What you can see is a pattern where you say destroy, regime change, rebuild. And that is why Japanese machinery is now driving around in Afghanistan making new roads. That's an American machine from the US Department of Defense. The whole Western society jumps in at the moment when they can, and then money is being made on rebuilding. It can be hard to know who you can trust and not. So I made a little instruction here. Those are the moderate Syrian rebels, and those we like. And just to make clear, I've put in a little Super Mario, because they are the good guys, even if they don't look like it. They're the good guys too, the Saudi Arabians. They chop off some heads, but it's Saudi way of living. But they are the good guys. They're the good guys too. They're Nazis, but what the heck? They're part of just one of 80 paramilitary Nazi groups in the Ukraine. So why not support them? Last week, actually, the U.S. Senate or the Congress, made a law saying that it's no longer allowed for American military to train exactly this regiment, the Azov regiment, because it's immoral what they do. The US Congress just banned this activity, so maybe we stop it now. But it's nothing new, and the CIA entered Ukraine in 1953. And why did they do that? They did that to Nazify the country. Why do I know that? Because I've read the papers published in 2015 about the origins of the CIA's relationships with the Ukrainian nationalists. So read that and stop any talk about coincidence or anything. These people are made by the CIA in a big operation called Project Aerodynamic in order to destabilize Ukraine, in order to finally install a right-wing government friendly to the USA. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what happened. We all supported Saddam Hussein until he went into Kuwait. We even delivered the gas that he used to kill the Kurds. So forget any talk about him all of a sudden being a bad guy. My good colleague John Pilger said that if journalists and broadcasters all over the world had done their jobs regarding the Iraq war, we would never ever have gone there. And that's true. And I can add to that, that goes for 9/11 too. We would never have entered in this meaningless war on terror if the journalists would just basically do their job. So they have a huge responsibility. And those journalists sitting out there, still in the mainstream media, they have to be on drugs, otherwise they can't live with themselves. It's a no-go. I don't know how they sleep at night, and I really don't care. Thank you. But but you might look at it objectively and say that the Iraqi invasion was the, until now, biggest terrorist operation in world history. In the very first attack, in the very few days, 173,000 people were killed. And in the years after, millions have died. So it's a huge-scale terror attack. And again, the infrastructure was destroyed, millions were homeless, and a bunch of money is made by the West in rebuilding the country again. It's good to be in Denmark. It's really good to be in Denmark. Anders, the folk of war, Rasmussen, says NATO has been the most successful. Thank you. It's not my invention, but he really deserves this nickname, Anders, the folk of war, Rasmussen. He calls NATO the most successful peace movement that the world has ever seen. He should be ashamed of himself, but I think he's really not able of being ashamed. He should ask the people in Belgrade, for instance, how do you feel about the NATO peacekeeping movement? Because that's what we did, keeping the peace. We bombed the hell out of this city and the country and destroyed a lot of lives, and all the same story over and over again. And it is no surprise, we know today, yes, behind that was the CIA, because the CIA supported, trained, and operated the so-called Kosovo Liberation Army. It's all a CIA-controlled operation. We know that too. I even called the Danish television many, many years ago, because, as I said to the editor, how come you just, it was called in Danish exactly Liberation Army, Befrielseshær. How can you use a name like that on one part of a war, indicating clearly that this is the good guys, and okay, then the other ones must be the bad guys. And they did change it. They did find some other, I don't know. But this is a fact. It was a CIA operation, and the NATO, the whole war was based on a lie of a genocide that didn't take place, period. And this, a lot of good journalists will tell you about. Yes, as I've made this myself, I've put myself in as well. But that's a very important point. I thought for years, for many years, I was the only journalist in the world, but I can promise you I am not. I am definitely not. We have, right now we have in German alone, we have 70 different authors. In the English version, I think we have 15 or 20, I don't remember. But point is, there are good journalists all over the world. They have left, they don't find them in the mainstream media because they're journalists. So they make websites, they publish books, they make lectures, they do whatever they can. And what we do on Free 21, we join, we connect them. So I'm almost at the end now. I have no idea how long I've been going, but I'm almost there. But briefly, Free 21 is, as I said, about reintroducing journalism. And of course, we have a website. On the website, you can find this magazine, and I've brought it here because we published this magazine. The idea is very simple. Here you have a traditional article. If you imagine this article being printed out as a Word document, it would have no value. If you imagine this article being printed out from a website where it was with HTML and all this stuff, you'd get out 7 pages and a lot of quotes, and it has no value. What we do, we lay out the story, and then we put it on the net in order for people to download it. We have, as I said, we have around 100 people now behind the system. We have groups of layouters, researchers, transcriptors doing videos, transcripts, copy-proof readers, all the stuff you need to make a newspaper, we have. And they sit all over the world, and we connect via the internet, and it's all running. So here you have the same article in Russian. We are about, as I said, a huge Russian project. As I stand here, a couple of articles will be translated into some languages that I don't even know. And when I get home, I'll put it on the website. So we have Hungarian articles, we have Turkish articles, we have Russian articles, it's all there. Here you have an article on Hungarian, I think. Point is, now this article can be printed out in Hungary. Every printer connected to the internet is our delivery route. So people can print it, and once printed, it can't be changed, can't be it can't be censored, can't be controlled, it can even be copied. That's why we say power to the paper. We make information analog, and analog information cannot be manipulated. So the knowledge, thank you. So it's very important, because the internet is full of bullshit as well as the mainstream media. So what we do, we try to find the credible things, and it's not that hard at all, because we always put in the sources. Point is, when you have made the layout like that on as day one, you can at any given time, you can go in and put together a standard magazine, because you've already done the job. The article is already there. You only need to touch it once. That's the principle. So every 2 months, we go through our website and I select 15 articles or something like that for the next number of the magazine, 52 pages. We published 150,000 copies last year in Germany. This year we are going to publish even more. We have founded a union in Germany running this whole thing. And we are coming with French versions, and it's really going to go through the rooftop, because anyone can participate. And what's there, you see the system. We have a lot of content, a lot of different articles, and we just choose the best ones and we put it in the magazine. There we have 1,400 subscribers. They get 10 copies each. Means you can't just get one. You get a little package with 10. And that's in order to create activism. Because what do you do with 9 extra magazines? Well, if you like the content, you give it to your friends. And that way, we have reached all levels of society in Germany. Young people tell me, for the first time, they're able to discuss these things with their parents, without their parents saying, oh, that's just some load of bullshit from the internet. No, it's not, because we put in the sources in the magazine. We do the job. We're journalists. We are not in the business of manipulating. So, thank you. And that is so comforting, experiencing this, because all over where I come, I meet people saying, this is good, go for it, keep doing so. And I mean, from living in Denmark, in the woods where I sat at the in the last days alone with my dog, and he was the only one believing me. I mean, it's really a paradise coming out there, because that is what the world needs. The world just needs free media, and then everything would be good. We would choose completely different politicians if we had free media. So we're going to do it. I can recommend a lot of these websites as well. You can just find them afterwards, but take care. Don't believe anything, you see, because the situation right now is very, very dangerous. The US is right now renewing, they're putting in new nuclear weapons in Europe as I'm speaking. Short-range weapons, and it's a very, very hard signal against the Russians. As Willy Wimmer says, the US is poisoning the climate in Europe. That makes my colleague say, a world war has begun. So break the silence. And it is time to break the silence. I'll rest my case with these very, very wise words from a very wise man. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you. Thank you.
It was absolutely marvelous lecture, and I'm very happy that you are from Denmark, really, because it really brings a lot of warmth in my heart.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
and I think he deserves simply such a wow clapping, even
thank
more.
You. Thank you.
Yeah. We don't ask Tommy Hansen questions now, but you can do it this afternoon, later on, when we have the panel debate. Right now we are going to, we say thank you, eh? And then the next... What's happened? I didn't see it. Well, anyway, the next lecture is with Jens Moore Tygesen, and he's going to, he's another Danish man. It's a really good. And he's going to talk about the Kennedy asset.